But just to start, I'm Leslie Farnsworth from the FrogDog team. Some of you know me, some of you don't. I've got with me Maddie Banta, also from the FrogDog team. Yeah, there you go. We're the two FrogDoggers that are leading this seminar series. I am the CEO, but I'm also really focused on and have a lot of strength and background in strategy and messaging. So I'm leading our conversation here today. Maddie is our lead head of everything digital at FrogDog. So she's got a lot of digital insights to share, and she'll be chiming in as well. I started FrogDog a long time ago. So in 1997, actually. And so I've kind of seen several business cycles where we've gone through different types of crises, certainly not a global pandemic yet, but a few different upturns and crises. And so I really wanted to try to also add any experience I could share about how to best handle messaging and marketing in crises periods based on my decades of experience at this point. So our agenda for today, we're going to cover the best practices and then try to dedicate as much of the call as possible to talking about specific questions, understanding everyone's specific situation, and then also helping, because the goal here is to give as much actionable advice as we can on each of these calls. And although some people are still joining, we do actually have people from all over the world on this call today, which is awesome. We've had people sign up. We have people joining from the Philippines. We have someone joining from Jamaica. We have people in Romania. We've also got people in the United States and Canada. So we really are covering the globe in a lot of ways. And I think as I saw people registering and signing up for this, it really drove home to me the fact that this is business in general is global today, right? We're all connecting and connected in so many ways on our day-to-day business level. But then also this crisis is global, right? So I think it's amazing to go, wow, yeah, okay, yeah, Jamaica, we'll be dealing with this. Yes, okay, the Philippines, they're dealing with this. As we all watch the news, we're seeing everyone deal with this. So I think it drives home not only the global nature of business today, but also the global nature of this crisis. So because everyone comes from different situations, we definitely are going to focus on the sort of high-level business practices in this first portion of the call. But I promise you that no matter whether you're a business selling to other businesses, you're a business selling to consumers, you're someone working in the government sector, trying to communicate to your target audiences in the public world, all of this applies to you. So all of the information you're going to get in this seminar applies to you, no matter what world you're in. And then we'll drill down into the specifics in the second portion of this call. And so I'm going to kind of dig into the slides right now. I'm going to try to cover these best practices with enough detail to make them helpful and actionable, but also quickly enough that we can get to the discussion section and I'll really share what we're going through, introduce ourselves at that phase, and conserve resources, our specific situations, even our specific insights. All of you, especially given the global nature, a lot of the attendees are going to have seen different things related to this. And at this time, we'll kind of ask questions and answer questions. But if, as we're going through these slides in the first portion of the call, you do have a question, go ahead and add them to the chat section of the meeting, or write them down if that's easier for you. And then we'll make sure we get them all addressed and we circle up on those in the discussion section of the call. And to add things to the chat section, you really just need to click for anyone new to Microsoft Teams, to click the little chat bubble in the horizontal menu bar at the bottom, and the chat meeting section will open up on your screen. So hopefully that'll help everybody with navigating the technology. I think everyone's having to navigate a lot of technology today. So there are these past couple of weeks anyway. So I'm going to dig in. Welcome to some of the new folks who just joined. Let's talk a little bit about what happens first. For some of us in this world, this has already happened. Some people are kind of in this mix right now. The first thing you need to do in a crisis situation is hurry up and pause everything. And that sounds contradictory, but it's so not, right? You, if you've already been through this phase, you've already done this. You might be doing it right now. You might not have done this and realize you really should have. All of these that you see on this slide here are immediate actions that you should take the moment a crisis has hit. let's talk about a crisis, right? There's really two types of crises in the macro sense. One is what we're experiencing with this COVID-19 disaster. It kind of wasn't a problem, even if we'd heard about it, until it suddenly was a problem for us in our reality, in our part of the world, in our business segment, right? It was sort of this slow build, and then bam, it hit us really hard. That's one type, the slow build crisis. The probably more typical crisis is something more sudden, right? A big natural disaster that hits, a terrorist attack, which is terrible, but something we've all seen in the news, or often even the death of a major public figure, whether it's in your city or your state or your nation or the world. When something big changes in your world or in the world of your target audience, the people you are trying to reach with your business, you need to race everything to pause, right? That is definitely, absolutely the social media campaigns. Anything social media that you have planned needs to stop. Anything email marketing-wise that you have planned needs to stop. A lot of us have those things automated. Get into those automation systems and hit pause on all of it. If you don't have it automated, you don't have to think twice about whether or not to send out an email on Wednesday. Don't send the email, just hold. You may decide to pause your pay-per-click campaigns if you're doing advertising with pay-per-click. You may also decide to pause your digital advertising campaigns. This pause the questions to ask yourself, right? It's really just a moment to catch your breath, stop everything, and decide what you should be doing given what's going on here, right? It's just long enough to take stock and adjust accordingly. So don't worry about, okay, but I don't really want to stop everything right now. How long is the stop going to happen? Maybe I shouldn't do it because I don't want to stop the business growth engine I have built. And to think through as you adjust, it's not a cancellation of anything. The real importance here and the real danger here is that if you don't stop everything to take stock of what's going on, you have a real, real danger of damaging your brand and your overall, the public goodwill for your organization. We all, in the last few weeks, have gotten email or have seen social media posts go out on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, wherever we were, that seemed completely tone deaf. And whereas we might have been okay with it in the day of the crisis when things hit, it's not okay a day later or 2 days later. And I have certainly seen a lot of backlash on brands just through observation from people who just forgot they had things automated and it was going, and they sounded tone deaf, they sounded out of touch, they sounded like they didn't care, that they were cold. And that is not what you want. It doesn't matter. Your business could be directly linked to this crisis. Stop everything for a minute. It's time well spent. Even if it feels like time wasted, stop everything. So what happens next? If you've done this, good for you. A lot of people obviously were surprised and didn't manage to stop everything in time. What do you do next, right? So in the moment, right, you've paused. In that one day of pause, or those
unknown
2 days
participant
of pause,
is now joining.
What do, right? You have to take that pause time to plan a short-term program. What do I mean by a short-term program, right? For your messaging, for everything else. I mean no more than a week's time. I mean figure out what you're gonna do in the next few days, 5 days, maybe 3 days, depending on your business. Gather your team, key internal staff, trusted advisors and peers. If you're in an organization, find someone else in a similar organization in a similar role and consider bringing them in as to share sort of insights and get an outsider's opinion. That's fine too. They might need your opinion. It could be helpful to everyone. Designate someone on this team. It might be you. For certain companies, it is the CEO or somebody in that sort of C-suite or EVP role, because this person needs to be able to make decisions in the moment about changing the short-term plan. Or if it's not that person who can make decisions in the moment, they need to be able to reach out to that person who is the decision maker and be able to get them at a moment's notice. What do you look at? What are you doing, right? Look at what you're saying, what activity can continue. What did you already have planned, right? So this is not set a whole new plan from scratch. Look at the plans you already had in place for your messaging for the week ahead and figure out what still works, right? What can you continue to maintain a baseline of communications in the near term, right? So no matter what's happening, I think this is important to say, no matter what's happening, other than that momentary pause we talked about to measure the climate, see what's going on, get a feel for public sentiment, you should never go completely dark, right? Take a pause, go dark for that day or two, but don't go completely dark. It's not a good idea in marketing. However, you should shift, right? So for example, I promise things we did do is we looked at all of the campaigns we had planned for clients, and we looked at what not only technically were we doing, but what were we saying? What anything that did not that seemed like it was contra to the crisis, was tone deaf for the crisis, wasn't addressing the crisis or appropriate or relevant to the crisis, we pulled. If it was not totally tone deaf, it still somewhat would work given what was going on. We continued to let it go forward, but we were careful about what those things were. So for example, retargeting efforts, we went ahead and decided to continue for client campaigns, but not certain things related to pay-per-click or digital display advertising necessarily, right? Also look at what should stop for a week when you're putting the short-term plan together. What should pause for a week's evaluation? Just while you get a feel for the longer-term play out of this crisis, right? We'll eventually get to the other side of this crazy thing. Could be email marketing campaigns. There's no point in spending the money or the effort at this stage to send out an email marketing campaign that you had already planned ahead of the crisis, because you'd probably plan something that's going to be a little off tone for what's currently going on. So this might be a good thing to just give it a week's break, reschedule that email marketing campaign, or just unschedule it for now. Conserving resources here is wise because you're going to need them on the back end. What do you need to cancel entirely? These items are highly time sensitive and they cannot be rescheduled. For example, during this COVID-19 crisis, anything messaging wise related to mid-March holidays and events got scratched. So anything you were doing related to conferences, anything you were doing related to events, anything tied to St. Patrick's Day, if you're that kind of business, had to just get scratched, because by the time this comes on the other side, it's irrelevant. We also at FrogDog decided to scratch any messaging we had, for example, around the week of April Fool's Day, which, oh, a little solidarity, I promise you, where people play gags and jokes. Our clients don't tend to participate in that by and large, but sometimes you'll make a reference to it, like, this isn't an April Fool's joke. This is a real thing. Not appropriate to do that in this mode. So those messages got completely reevaluated. And we'll get completely rewritten. Even if what we were promoting is still valid, even if the campaign is still valid, that sort of angle on the messaging is not. So don't do it. If you're in the US right now and you're looking at next week's campaigns, if you're looking at April 1st, don't do anything related to April 1st next week. Not a good idea. We also look at what needs to change in terms of your tone or your messaging. So likely, and probably 99.9% of the cases, whatever you decide to say in your marketing and sales activity and the week or two after a crisis must shift. It has to shift. Doesn't mean you don't continue to do things, but you probably need to rethink what you're saying when you do it, right? How do you shift your messaging so that you don't seem out of touch and cold? There's nothing, we've all gotten it. I'm the CEO of a company. I've gotten so many sales pitches in the last 2 weeks, and at first you forgive and then you get extremely angry. Walking you through my own emotions where you're just like, are you kidding? You're trying to sell me some kind of software as a service for recruitment. Right now is not the time. Right. So be thinking about that, right? Doesn't mean that they couldn't reach out to me with something, but the way they were doing it made it seem like they were completely oblivious to what's happening in the world. It doesn't build goodwill. Right. An example on some of our client stuff is we decided to create new email messages, new marketing pieces that at least spoke to the campaign, spoke to the crisis for the world, just to try to make sure that that we understood what was going on for that target audience and what they were facing. And we'll continue to evaluate as the weeks go forward, right? So we will look at kind of everything we have planned on a week-to-week basis for the near term. We'll talk about that and how we do that in a second. Do determine, as you were looking at your short-term plan, your 1 week plan, based on what's happening with this crisis, determine, ask yourself, ask your advisors whether you should offer or develop a separate campaign or message that's just tied to the crisis. My philosophy after decades of doing this is to hold entirely on any crisis-focused campaigns unless you have a specific crisis-related need to address to your target audience. Examples related to the COVID-19 crisis include banks, right? We have a fiscal drama going on. Banks have needed to kind of tell people what, and credit card companies, what's happening with their accounts, can they get access to them, can they delay payments if they've got a mortgage, those kinds of communications, that needs to happen. That has to happen, right? So those kinds of organizations should speak to that. Maddie and I were talking ahead of this call. She mentioned shelters in Houston, Texas that had capacity and availability. I think that was a great, they did have something to contribute here. So if you have either a crisis-related need that your target audience needs a communication on, absolutely create a special message for them. If you also have something to contribute to the discussion that you feel like you can help people, like the shelter, saying we have capacity, go ahead and develop a special message related to the crisis at hand. For example, right, this seminar series, we went ahead and decided to create this seminar series and to also send out an email about it because we felt like we had valuable experience to share, having gone through crises and marketing for decades now. However, we're not using this as a sales pitch. It's just really an attempt to try to help where we can in a really stressful time for a lot of people in business. FYI, you're not going to get a sales pitch as part of the seminar series. I promise. We are not going to be doing that. So we understand, and I would definitely say what we understand is that it's really, really hard. It is for our clients. It is for us. It's a hard recommendation to make, even to ourselves who've done this several times. It is a hard thing to stop all growth-related activity, to stop prospecting, to stop marketing, to stop everything, even when it fits for a week or two. Even if it's like, well, I better pause that email for the next week or two. I promise you that doing so in the short term will pay dividends in the long term. We're going to talk a little bit about how in the silver lining section of this presentation we have coming up. But be aware that in the immediate term after a crisis, you can waste effort and budget fruitlessly and possibly negatively if you are not careful. So the short-term program that we're talking about here is where it makes sense to conserve resources and to monitor the situation. Any messages you had planned will probably still be valuable and valid in a few weeks, in a couple of months. So you're going to need those resources, anything you would be spending right now, use those resources later to play catch up with your marketing and your sales efforts and really come out ahead. That's actually a topic of a future seminar too. So next, right? So what happens after you've developed your short-term plan and you've got that running, right? You've delegated that out to everybody. Everybody's working on the short-term plan, getting it all done. What do you do while that's happening? In the week that you've got this going on, what happens, right? Weed the waves is what I call it, right? And I call it read the waves because it feels like that. You're going to need to set a weekly marketing plan during the crisis period, and it's probably going to have to happen on a weekly basis for at least 4 months, 4 weeks. Sorry, not months. Hopefully it doesn't go on that long. But weeks worth, you're going to need to say, okay, every week we sit down and we figure out what are we going to do next week. We go back to those questions we talked about a second ago. What do we need to keep going? What do we need to pause? What can we turn back on? What do we need to adjust? Because the sentiment of the public is going to change constantly in the middle of all of this, right? So sending marketing emails related to the coronavirus crisis made sense in the first couple of days. However, public sentiment quickly shifted. People were getting tons of emails, totally unrelated to anything. And you could see if you're reading the public sentiment through social listening, we'll talk about that in a second, that people shifted from being thankful for insights to being frustrated with sort of this overwhelming amount of email and social media that was just felt like to them insensitive because they felt like companies were trying to capitalize on a serious situation, right? So public sentiment in a crisis comes in waves. It's like a wave of grief, I think, in a way, right, where people swing between, and it can happen in an hour or two. It's shocking. And it also happens as news changes, right? So they swing between panic, anger, frustration, thankfulness, resignation, indignation, grief, beyond, right? All the spectrum, all the color of human motion will take place, right? So your weekly marketing assessments need to take these waves into account. You need to be kind of reading the waves and taking measurement of those waves. How do you do that is a common question. Those of us in marketing have tools, often paid tools, that we do that with. But there's also options to do this without having to pay for it. I'll talk to you guys about both. Free things to do is just kind of watch all the news, look at all the commentary, even if it's not news that you typically read or value. It is part of what the public is reading and your target audience is reading. So read everything that they're reading. Keep an eye on all of that. Just get a feel for what their tone is. People on your sales team or your development team through your longer term, even still, either because those conversations were scheduled before the crisis hit, or just because they're reaching out to touch base with people and make sure they're okay in all of this. Salespeople are wonderful for those direct contacts and also for those insights. Reach out to them. They should be definitely a part of these conversations around messaging. What are they hearing? What is the target audience going through? Look at social media as well, because it's a very valuable barometer of public sentiment. However, I caution you a couple things. A lot of what people do when they look at social media is they just are looking at their own personal accounts. That's great, but there's a bit of an echo chamber there. You're really only seeing what your network is posting, whether that's your personal network or your business network. You are not seeing what the general public is saying or doing or thinking. So look at those by all means, but don't look at those and assume, well, that's the public conversation, because it's kind of not. What you should be doing, the free option to measure public sentiment on social media is actually to go to Twitter. I know. Some people are like, oh no, but if you go to Twitter, there's actually a lists feature and you can for free set up a list for different keywords that you find interesting. You don't have to follow the people having these conversations. They don't need to follow you. But if you put keywords in there that you want to follow, whether it's for certain industries, whether it's for certain subjects, whether it's for certain types of products and services, you can create a list for each one of those. And you can periodically look at those lists, and it'll bring in from all over the Twitterverse all of the different types of information that you have that people are talking about related to that subject matter. So it's a very, very helpful way. It's a bit manual, takes some time to go in there and set up all these keywords and create all these lists, but hugely helpful way to, at any time of the year or the cycle, get insights into your target audience without following them or them following you. But especially when you're in a crisis period and sentiment's coming and changing constantly. Also, very, very true, every publication you ever meet and every journalist you ever meet is on Twitter. So you also are going to be in the same feed, not just getting the general public's sentiment on this, but you'll also be following your specific news media's and journalists specific to your topic, what they're saying and what they're covering right now. It's incredibly helpful. What did you plan tools-wise? Before we get to paid tools, if your marketing team has access to Google Analytics or the Google Search Console, you can use that, or Google Trends. May not be something that everybody has access to, but your marketing team probably does.
Google Trends is accessible to anyone. Right. Yeah, so you can go to Google Trends and kind of see broader search trends, what people are looking for, where you don't really have, you can program it like what's United States or what's trending. You can, again, just get a sense of broader trends, and you can just log on to Google Trends to get those. It's another great free resource out there.
That's true, and that's really helpful, too. Where Google is more of a, you're seeing what people are talking about, what they're putting, I mean, not Google, Twitter shows you what people are talking about. Google Trends will show you what people are searching for, right? So those are two sort of pillars here that help you understand where people's heads are, especially related to anything that you're doing. And it'll help you make sure that any message you develop right now is in tune with public sentiment. And because that sentiment's going to be coming in waves, you need to be pretty much looking at this minimum weekly, if not daily, especially in the first few days. So this is where having that point person who's really looking at that constantly and has that as their job to keep an eye on everything, to brief everybody, to say, hey, I know we thought it was okay for us to have that email go out on Wednesday. I've seen some things for the last 24 hours makes me think we need to hold. And Maddie and I can tell you last week that definitely happened. We went from Monday to, okay, you know what, that email that we have scheduled for later this week for a client campaign, I think it's fine. to Wednesday morning going, no, 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 pull it. We're going to reschedule it. And we did. We've rescheduled it. It's going to happen. It's just not happening this week. So
another good one
change daily.
Yeah, another good one to monitor, kind of like Twitter, is Reddit, where Reddit's comprised of subreddits. And so you can follow a subreddit or even just see the whole Reddit, what's trending, or you can look at ones that are more specific to your industry, to your interests. And again, you know, kind
unknown
of see
participant
what that,
is now exiting.
A little notification. And just see what's going on there. So Reddit and Twitter, you know, I think you kind of structure them similarly where you go into subtopics, but they're again just great free resources to see what the conversations are, what people are, what matters to people at that moment, and what the tone is in different places.
Awesome. Yes, thank you, Maddie. So there are tools up there. Some of them cost, some of them don't cost. It really just kind of depends on, you know, how much agency you have, how much budget you really want to spend to keep an eye on all of that. But you don't have to pay anything at this point, especially given so much is out of control right now, if you don't have to. So what happens next? All right, so you've got your week-to-week plan going. You've got at least 2 to 4 weeks of week-to-week plans underway. You're reviewing them every week. You're looking at what needs to change. You've got somebody on point, looking at your messaging in alignment with that general public conversation. What happens in that 2 to 4 week time period? This is when you can really work to sort of set a longer term plan. You will know that it is time to set a longer term plan when you've got a slightly calmer waves, right? Calmer waters signal that you can shift from week to week planning to longer term planning, with a note that this does not mean long term planning. We're not, unfortunately, at the long term planning phase yet. Right. At this phase, when you see that waters are a little bit calmer and you can move away from having that every single week message review, you can look at longer term planning, which could mean 3 to 6 months only, could mean only 1 to 3 months at a time. Really depends on the industry you're in, the products you offer, your target audience, who you're talking to, how close or how distant it is from the nature of the crisis, right? So that this gets really specific, and I'm very interested in hearing where everybody is on that spectrum when we get to the discussion, because I think this is where things get a little less everybody do this and a little more, that's going to depend, right? What questions should you ask yourself as you develop this longer term plan, right? As you're looking at your messaging going, okay, the water's a little bit calmer, everyone has moved into a little more stabilized emotions, the public sentiment has kind of stabilized a little bit. What do I need to do? What has to happen to my overall messaging plan, my marketing plan, what I'm planning to say? So here are the questions to kind of think through as you go through this, right? Has the crisis, it's really three, has the crisis made your planned messaging seem off kilter in any way? Even now that the initial waves of crisis and emotion have subsided a bit, right? So when you're looking at your key audiences, have some of the things you were planning to say at this time become mine a little bit, but by and large, what you were not connected or less likely to hit home than they would have before the crisis happened, right? If so, you have a to-do, and that to-do is you've got to adjust your messaging to better suit the public sentiment and perspective, right? You need to shift. Number two, has the new world order changed the effectiveness of any of your marketing tactics, right? So if you've got a certain kind of message, the types of ways you deliver that message change, right? You've always got to have an alignment between what you're saying and how you're saying it, right? Has that alignment shifted related to this crisis, right? Also, are any of the things you had planned to do really no longer appropriate, right? So let's just say that you had planned to do a lot of speaking with your target audience at an event or at a conference coming up. Obviously, for all of us, that has canceled for the foreseeable future. I've seen some of them have canceled entirely. Some of them are getting rescheduled for the fall. That's fine. You may not want to and probably should not wait to have conversations with your target audience until whenever that conference happens. You need to plan some messaging and some methods for delivering that messaging for the near term, for sooner than then, right? you may still do it then, but you will need to do it sooner than then. Let's just put it that way, right? Also, a lot of things that were related to out-of-home advertising. Out-of-home advertising is stuff that's, you see it on billboards, you see it on bus station stops and in buses, things like that, flyers, anything like that that people got out in the world while they were walking around, while they were attending an event, going to a show, whatever it is. If you have marketing that's that kind of relation, it's not going to work anymore. It's wasted money. It won't get anyone angry, but they're not even going to see it. So that's another example of like, okay, my messaging might still be valid, but I was planning to deliver it in this way, and what I was saying in it worked for it being delivered in that way. It doesn't work when it's not a billboard. It doesn't work when it's not at an event. So I need to shift my messaging. I need to shift my tactical plan in the near term, because what I thought I was going to do wasn't going to work. Another thing to think about with COVID-19, if any of you have pay-per-click marketing tactics, that means that somebody goes to Google, Bing, wherever, and they're typing in something related to your product or service, and that you're paying per click. Be very careful right now, because A, people are really not searching. You can see this across all the grids in all of the different tools. People are really not searching by and large for things that A, they can't get delivered to their home easily, but also really, especially right after the crisis, they weren't searching for things that weren't related to the crisis. There was an interesting discussion among marketing folks that somebody had, and they typed up a little mini case study and shared it, that somebody had a pay-per-click marketing campaign going on for face masks, and they meant the cosmetic kind that you put on your face if you want to look less wrinkly, let's say. They had a huge everyone, but I promise you that have spiked, and they paid a fortune because, yes, people were searching for face masks, but a completely different type of face mask. And so all those clicks, all those impressions, wasted budget, right? So there's an element of wasted budget. People are going to click stuff, and they're not getting what they were looking for, so you aren't actually going to get a return on that investment. And then secondly, you're probably going to tank anyway because people aren't looking, you know, for pretty much for event venues right now, party planning, travel agents, lots of different stuff. If you're paying for pay-per-click advertising, that probably needs to change in the near term, right? So things like that. Look at, what's my message? Does that need to shift? How am I delivering it? Does that need to shift given what's going on in the world, right? And then also, given the immediate term disruption, right? So when I told you to pause, and then I said, look, you're going to have to stop certain things and reschedule certain things in the first week or two after the crisis, maybe 4 weeks after the crisis. Do you now need to increase your frequency to ensure you don't lose ground, right? That you don't lose market share even more than you would have otherwise? And when we say frequency, we mean maybe before you were sending out one email marketing thing a month. It may mean, I don't know, so dependent upon your business, you really need to do two a month for a little while after the waves subside to catch up, right? To get back into front of people, break through the noise, to rebuild the frequency that you lost and that overall brand awareness that you lost when you took a bit of a break, right? So when I said, look, conserve energy and conserve resources in that first week or two after a crisis, that's what I mean, because you're going to be using them just at a slightly later date. So as you look at that longer term planning, these are the questions to ask yourself and to think through as you adjust your messaging and you adjust your overall plan. So we're getting close to the finally, I promise. So finally, what happens next, right? So we've gotten through some longer term planning. What happens next? So I promise you guys, it may feel like it's never going to happen. We will eventually get to the other side of this crazy thing. We always do. So a little solidarity. I promise you it'll eventually be over. We will have a new normal. The thing to realize is it's a new normal. It is not going to be what it was like before the crisis, at least not for a long time. People's worlds have shifted. Their thinking has shifted. If nothing else, they're all doing a lot more video conferencing than they ever were before. So regardless, people's behaviors and attitudes have changed, right? So as you get through the crisis period, as you get through your longer term plan, you will have had time to kind of read the waves. You will have looked at kept your ear to the ground. You will have kept really close eye on public sentiment. This is when you kind of look at your longer term strategy. What did you planned for 2020 before COVID-19 happened, right? What did you think you were going to be doing? What did you think you were going to be saying? And figure out, and what's happening now, right? Your ear to the ground is going to help you determine what needs to happen now and whether or not, per what you see on this slide, option A or option B are the better option, right? Either A, you can easily go back to the campaign you'd planned before the crisis, right? Maybe you've got to adjust the messaging just a tiny bit. Maybe you got to, you know, adjust the overall timeline a little bit. But by and large, what you had planned to do for 2020, you can still do. We either just got a shifted timeline where things moved back, or you've got a gap in your timeline, or a mix of both, right? But by and large, you can keep doing what you were doing, just a slightly different timeline. Option B is that you've got to rework your long-term plan completely, right? And that's a lot more stressful on everyone. But I promise you that having all of these insights that you've gathered over the months of short-term and then longer-term planning will help you figure out whether or not you need to completely overhaul your marketing, right? Has the crisis caused long-term changes in your market or with your target audience? If the answer to either one of those is yes, your market has changed or your target audience has changed, even if it's just it's changed in the way they think about things related to your business, you will need to overhaul your business. You will need to overhaul your messaging and everything else, right? You also may realize through this process that your business strategy needs to pivot. That's a much bigger conversation. But if your business strategy needs to pivot, this is the time to decide rather than continuing to try to push boulders uphill and realize you need to make some changes before you've wasted a bunch of time, energy, and resources, right? So you might decide my business needs to change, and you also may just decide, okay, my marketing needs to change, right? So it may be 3 to 6 months as your longer term plays out before you can develop that long-term plan. But what you need to really make sure you're doing is you're doing it with that new normal mindset in mind. It will be different on the other side of this. But to kind of ahead of the discussion section, I want to definitely point out the fact that experience has shown me over decades in crises that there are silver linings here. I wish we weren't having to go through a crisis to get them. But through doing these things, through going through this highly stressful period where you're adjusting everything, you're relooking at everything, all the stuff you thought you had planned, that you felt really good about, that you were extremely positive about going into 2020, and that you're having to suddenly in the moment change everything you had planned, as stressful as that is, I promise you it's worth it. Because in the very long term, right, you're going to have preserved or even improved, which is, it happens. I've seen it every single time. There are companies who have improved their brand and the overall goodwill of the general public in their company, right? You'll have higher brand equity if you do this right. You'll have preserved your marketing resources. You will not have spent marketing budget or marketing time and energy fruitlessly. I mean, there's nothing worse than continuing to try to throw people's energy and money at marketing when it's not going to work anyway. Conserve those resources, right? You will have actually, in the middle of a crisis, have generated actual results rather than just have spun your wheels. You will have maintained your marketing leverage and traction. A lot of people's knee-jerk reaction here is to just stop everything marketing-related, everything prospect-related, do nothing. To take that pause we talked about at the beginning of this conversation and just make it a pause that goes on for months, that is the absolute wrong thing to do. They lose a ton of traction. They lose a ton of leverage. They completely backtrack themselves when it comes to overall brand awareness and brand equity. Don't do it. You will have gotten through those weekly and monthly reviews of public sentiment and the target audience. You'll have incredible insights into what's needed and the long-term adjustments and what's happening with your target audiences. And because there are so many companies right now that are going to pause and do nothing, you will have gained incredible competitive advantage. On the other side of this upheaval, which again, I promise you there is going to be one, you will have come out incredibly far ahead of the competition because you have planned accordingly and done what you needed to do to adjust your messaging and shift.